Well, good afternoon. I hope you're enjoying the show. Thank you all for coming. This session is slightly different than some of the others. We're going to be looking at some of your questions that you tweeted to us. I've got a series of questions here and general purpose questions. And I also have an illustrious panel of people who have very kindly given up their time this afternoon to answer any of your questions and niggles, should you be so disposed to ask them or share them with us. So, if you'd like to, the easiest way to introduce yourself, okay, from the end, Mr. Featherstone, if you would.
Indeed. Hello, I'm Martin Featherstone. I'm one of the presenters and signal distribution specialists with HowToAV. So, if you have seen the channel, you've probably seen me talking about some of the technologies, including HDMI and HDBaseT. And I also work with CIE-Group as well.
Roland.
I'm Roland Hemming. I'm an independent audio consultant. We design audio systems, we manage large audio projects, and we also advise manufacturers on new audio products.
Jane.
Hello, I'm Jane Hammersley. I'm currently working with Maverick, along with their whole teams across Europe, and specializing on collaboration technologies, meeting room technologies, meeting room efficiencies. And I also work with Infocom on their leadership search committee, Infocom being the audiovisual industry body.
Thank you, Jane. Steve.
Hi there, and I'm Steve Collin. I also am here with HowToAV. I also work with CIE. I'm the group sales director there and mainly focus on the future of our product ranges and where the business is going.
And they're all lovely people and they're here and eager to answer your questions should you have any. But the first one, rolling off, which distribution technology will be adopted for AV systems in the long run, HDBaseT or IP, and what time frame for this change? Martin.
Discuss. I think we'll start with the end of the question. When does it happen? It's happening now. The IP stroke HDBaseT and generic signal distribution technologies are all changing as we speak. There are many IP technologies available at the moment which are becoming more reliable. I think over the last few years people have been watching the space to see how it moves and to see how these technologies work and how reliable they are as well, because obviously if they're being deployed in a signal distribution environment for digital signage, it's absolutely implicit that they work and they're reliable. And the last thing you want is the signal to disappear during a football game or during, you know, a stock exchange where you've got, you know, information coming up. And if the signal doesn't make it for some reason, then that could, you know, have serious repercussions. So in terms of the technologies, I think IP, it depends on the application. I think if you've got a single source going to multiple endpoints, in, let's say, for example, a sports arena environment, then IP could be a really, really useful solution for you. Again, it has its pros and cons. There are price implications with the technology being quite new at the moment. The price of IP products are still quite high. When you start to look at things like HDBaseT, again, the technology started sort of up here in terms of its price bracket, but it is starting to come down. And there's more and more manufacturers, you know, putting products out there now. I think in terms of reliability, if you've ever got a point where you've got a source and a sink or an endpoint, and you've got data going down that source, if it's a point-to-point scenario, there's less chance of things going wrong in between. So a signal is like, you know, with HDBaseT, you've got the ability to then sort of tee off from that and then go off to different screens as well. So I think it's a very rhetorical question. It depends on the application and it depends on what you're trying to do with it. Again, HDBaseT has other pros as well in terms of multiple signals, so single point into multiple outputs. HDBaseT matrices as well, so if you've got multiple signals going into the system being distributed to multiple endpoints, you've also got the different feature sets including Ethernet at the endpoints, which is distributed through the 5-play of HDBaseT, power at the receiving end as well. So there's lots of different facets to the question, but it really, it depends on the application.
There's no coincidence I'm doing a cabling and connectors feature for this issue, and I've found part of this area utterly impenetrable, and thinking, well, I'm not a cable guy, but I always start with the application, try and work myself back. I mean, for a buyer, the way you think, Jane, but it's all part of the complex process of evaluating spec, isn't it? I mean, how much
totally
how much attention do you pay to the distribution of an element?
I think one of the factors Martin just talked about there is the reliability. So the application, if it's mission critical, stock exchange, we've then got to pick on the right way to deliver the application and the source. And obviously stock exchange is a great example of where we need that application. Yes, if a football game goes down, yeah, it's not really the end of the world. Sorry, guys. So absolutely, I would say the same as you, Clive. Start at the application and work back. See what the end user's critical business need is on that, and then deliver the technology that's going to support that consistently and reliably every time.
I know you're going to give me a black eye if I don't mention audio.
No, yeah, audio I was just to say audio. Well, the audio side, I mean, is going IP. Our estimate on the whole of professional audio is still, it's just single-digit percentage of how many projects are actually using IP audio. But also from a survey we did last year, we're putting in there's going to be a 50% growth this year.
That
in,
much.
In the use of it. So the use of IP for audio using one of your favourite audio network standards, of which there were several, is undergoing huge growth.
How have you worked that out?
We surveyed several hundred people using network technology.
Truth.
Wow.
Massive. Steve, what about you? Have you got anything to contribute? I mean,
I think that the key thing there, and in the audio world as well as the signal distribution world, which is taking that audio signal as well, if you want to, from an HCMI perspective, it really does rely on the network. Because are you looking at an intranet, or are you looking at the wider Ethernet? Because if you look at something like Dante, for example, it's sitting on its own network. It's not actually on the open, wider world. So you can do various things with that. And it's been used for quite a long time now, and very successfully in I think, like the bigger events kind of marketplace. But now when we're seeing various projects like REF bases and the like being done with audio over IP using just standard networks and the wider network, it's working quite well and quite robustly. So that's good. And the same thing there goes back into the signal distribution of the video. If you want that localized network, then that's where your HDBaseT comes in quite well. But if you're going to go on a wider base and you want to go one point to many, then maybe that's where you're going to go over the IP side of things, which people have mooted that new term HDBitT now, which is not the HDBaseT, which is a different technology altogether.
I mean, in a sense, this is core AV, isn't it? But you're sort of straying into IT territory, in a sense. I've always regarded it as a sort of core IT territory, really. Mm. But, I mean, especially with new Infocom standards coming up about cabling and so on, it's becoming a bit of, well, I've always thought of a bit of a black art, but it's becoming even more quite a complex thing to plan for and get right, really.
I think it depends on your cable network as well. As Steve was saying, if you're dealing with a legacy system and you've got what you've got, then perhaps you need to find the solution which suits that problem, you know, to the best of its capability. So if, for example, you've got a fairly sort of robust network in place, but you're unable to put more cable in there, then you go with an IP solution. Mm. If you're able to put a point-to-point solution and you can have the luxury of putting more cable in the system and upgrading it from Cat5e to Cat6 or Cat7 as we move forward, then perhaps that's the way to go. So again, it's as Jane was saying, it's all about taking a detailed brief or looking at the problem that you have or looking at what you're trying to achieve and then work from there. Mm. Because otherwise, if you start with all the technology that's here at this show, you'd be looking around for months and months and months, and you'll never find what you're after.
I don't know what the results are from Roland's research, but we're certainly seeing in our day-to-day questions and answers that we're getting on audio over IP that the main architecture of a project and a structure is being done over IP, and then potentially the back end of it is still going back to that analog and distribution side of things. So we're, instead of going all the way into IP straight away, we're starting off with that architecture or structure of the solution and then finishing off with your traditional analog solution, which is where we're seeing most common uptake.
Yeah, it's definitely still a mixture at the moment, but that's changing fast. It's getting to the point with some product categories where you're not going to have a choice. Because you've only got space to put one connector on, or they're only going to pay to allow one set of technology on. So, for example, a number of new microphones got launched at ISE, and they were network only. There is no analog version of it. You have to buy the network version. And so, what are you going to plug it into? Another network device. You're sort of forced down that way, whether you like it or not. And that's going to become increasingly common.
Well, this is, how, I mean, how far are the manufacturers driving this? How much is in the hands of the user buying the stuff? I mean, as you say, it's being driven by whoever's releasing the product, aren't they, to a degree?
I think it's being pushed from both sides, to be honest. The manufacturers aren't going to do something where they know that there'll be resistance.
I mean, standards are dictating what's going on anyway, aren't they? I suppose HDBaseT has a tremendous problem.
Like,
and we're going to that audio networking transition, aren't we, into where we're going to go next, analog or IP.
Yeah, and it's happening faster with audio because audio, frankly, is less bandwidth, which is less cost. Mm-hmm. Although I would say that it's still got a whole lot of, you know, it doesn't just work. You've still got to have a reasonable number of skills. We discussed this yesterday that the sound engineer of the future, he or she may be 50% network engineer and 50% sound engineer.
How interesting. Goodness me. Oh, we'll discuss a bit more about that, actually. Mm. Anybody else got any cabling problems? I mean, anybody else had these sort of problems in their installations at all?
I was going to say, because you were talking about networked audio, I mean, our recent projects have involved a mixture of Dante and AVB, and we've still got existing CobraNet. It's a question of how to move forward, you know, and what would the panel's advice be on? I know it's difficult to say, but what is the way to move forward? I would say we've invested mostly in AVB, and I'm just hoping we haven't backed the wrong horse, you know.
If you read our blog, we think as technology, AVB is great, absolutely fantastic, but we think it's being done in the wrong order. When you look at this industry in general, it's a parasitic industry. We normally take our technology from elsewhere. So all our signal processing came from the telephone industry. All our networking technology came from the IT industry, and we've said, we'll have that. What I think should have happened with AVB is it should have been introduced by Cisco and HP, go into switches, and then in about 10 years' time, we'd have sat here today, have you heard about this technology? It's been in these switches for about 10 years, and it's all in about 30% of the world's switches now. We could start using that. Whereas what's happened is you've had this quite poor audio industry relatively trying to spearhead this technology that isn't being widely adopted. So that's where we think the problem with AVB, not with anything fundamentally wrong with it as a technology.
You just wonder who drives all this stuff, whether it's manufacturers on standards bodies or whether it's actually real user need. I've always wondered about that. Are we dealing actually with the best technological solution we can find? Or are we dealing with something the manufacturers are forcing on us as a necessary accepted standard? Mm. I'm talking to a journalist here, and I'd be an awkward sod, but you know, just devil's advocate as usual.
Yeah.
And sometimes, really, I think it's the latter. You know, it's something that's forced onto us rather than necessarily. I think HDBaseT is different. I think you can clearly see some really good benefits coming down the line.
Indeed, yeah. I think you're right. I think the manufacturers do force it down people's necks a little bit. I think, without going into too much detail, but the 4K is a good example. You look a few years ago at the last Football World Cup, everywhere, you look, all the advertising hoardings were all 4K. It was all about 4K screens. It's all about delivering 4K content. But at the time, the technology wasn't quite there. Actually, recording 4K wasn't an issue, and actually, you know, getting the content. But there was nobody broadcasting it. There was no sources out there that were 4K either. And even the standards on the screens weren't quite correct either. There was no HDCP 2.2. There was no HDMI 2. So a lot of people that have found themselves with, you know, £20,000 screens at the time that the screens were launched are actually useless 6 to 8 months later, which is a terrible shame. And that is, you know, really the blame lays at the door of the manufacturers. But then as things move on and then the technology moves on quite quickly, within 18 months of that, we're in a position where the standard is almost there. And that's probably the time for people to actually buy as well. So it's no bad thing. And at some point you do have to start, but if you buy in at that early point, perhaps you may get your fingers burnt.